Scranton, Pennsylvania is more than the sixth largest city in the Commonwealth, with a rich history of coal, iron, and steel. It's more than the site of our country's first electric-powered streetcars, or the second largest St. Patrick's Day parade. It's more than the television setting for a fictional paper company, or the birthplace of our nation's sitting vice president. Scranton is a city of tight-knit communities, sharing a love of family, faith, and food.
Well, I like to think about the time that before we were all born, when this was a great industrial city. And I see some of that in some of the architecture, like the gas company and the hotel, the former train station from which I went to college every time I visited home. And that kind of inspires me, not to recreate it, but to take up the energy that made that happen and translate it into something for today and tomorrow.
My fondest memories are childhood of our neighborhoods, where everybody took care of each other, and we felt safe. We walked into each other's houses without knocking on the door. Nobody had their doors locked in those days. We'd be out playing, our parents would call us home for dinner. As soon as dinner was over, we'd go back out in the neighborhood and play, and everybody felt safe. Nobody was afraid.
This was the heart of the region without any question. I still believe it is, but it was special. You came downtown, it was special. The impact that it's had on me, you know, it's almost like asking a fish, what's the impact of water on your life? I mean, I'm so immersed in this city and in this region. This is where I was born. This is where my roots are. They will always be here.
I think of the history of Scranton as the history of a community always striving to move forward, even if it was at a pace different than the rest of the world. I always think of it as a community that has been always looking to extract the best of the wisdom of those who have tried before and those who are trying now to advance the best interests of all, and to do it truly for the common good, not just the selective good.
Going back to our, you know, being the center of the anthracite region and fueling the anthracite or the industrial revolution, as was the case, the tremendous changes in, you know, that went along with the labor laws and the court cases that took place here, moving all the way through to some of the aspects of our history that allowed us to become an example for other communities that were struggling when coal mining was dying. How did the community react? Quite honestly, self-serving when I say this, things like the Scranton Plan, SLIBCO, in our own pull yourself up by the bootstraps kind of a mentality, that was echoed and mirrored all over the country. People used that. We were written up in national publications. We were Look Magazine, All America City in the 1950s because of the way we were able to recover on our own. And it's really, again, I still say that we set the standard for an awful lot of what happened in this country as we saw what had to be done and realized that if we didn't do it, it wasn't going to get done.
You know, most people think or have thought in the past that Scranton is or has been a coal town, which it has been. But it started as an iron and steel town. The Industrial Revolution in the United States was born in eastern Pennsylvania, in the Lehigh Valley and in the Lackawanna and Wyoming valleys. The remnants of that are here today, but you can see pictures of the steel mills, the iron furnaces, etc. And eventually as they moved west, we were left with the kind of the raw material, which was anthracite coal.
In 1902 was the great anthracite coal strike. Went from, I believe, April to October, and shut down entirely the coal industry. Coal at that time was used for heating, for fuel. It was what everybody used, like oil today. If there had been, you know, there was a strike in Saudi Arabia and they stopped producing oil, it would be the same kind of effect today. Roosevelt got involved as the strike continued and continued and continued. As it was getting toward winter, there was a legitimate concern that people would freeze to death in the winter without the coal to heat their homes. George Bear, who was, I believe the president of the Pennsylvania Coal Company at the time, had a rather high-minded idea that it was his manifest destiny, basically, to kind of be a jerk, and that it was his right to put down his workers, and he didn't have to make any concessions. And Roosevelt threatened to throw him out the window of the Rose Room in the White House. They were eventually able to come to a concession, and the miners ended up going back to work, I believe, the middle of October, with minor concessions. They had advocated for an 8-hour day. They were able to get a 9-hour work day. The price of their wages was increased slightly, but it was kind of the beginning of the end of that horrible, oppressive mining era.
The seminal period in Scranton's history occurred basically from World War II until the 1950s. The reason I say that is because, wearing the chamber hat, that's the period where, when coal had left the area's value from an economic standpoint, and the war effort was winding down, that's when the people of Scranton came together, the leaders, the business leaders, the community leaders, and the citizens came together to raise the dollars necessary to bring in business. And things changed dramatically in the 50s and 60s because of that community support.
This was always an entrepreneurial area. Because with coal and with iron and with steel came banks, newspapers, services, radio stations, later television stations, the whole panoply of culture. We were very fortunate in our misfortune, and that is that we didn't rebuild the city in a kind of completely modernistic, soulless way. And because of that, there are an awful lot of particularly young men and young women who are looking for authenticity in their environment, in their surroundings. And they're coming to cities, not just Scranton, but cities like Scranton, which they prefer to the suburbs or to a city that may be more modern and less soulful.
It is a corner of God's world that is marked by celebrations, whether it is La Festa Italiana, whether it's the Friendly Sons, whether it is the St. Joseph's Festival each summer, whether it is the St. Patrick's Day Parade, or any other event. And I would say that we all have funny memories and funny stories to tell of each. I recall being at La Festa Italiana many years ago with Bishop Timlin and with Monsignor McGowan, and all three of us were trying to speak Italian. That was funny in and of itself. I'm the person who thought I was saying good afternoon for the first 6 months I lived in Italy, only to discover that even though my American friends would not correct me, I was saying happy tomato to everybody I walked by in Italy at that time.
What we've come from, and I was just reading the 150-year, the book that that the Times put out. I was reading it, and there's so much. We've come from so little to become so much that sometimes I just think to myself, man, do we really realize what we have here? We've come a long way. We've made our mark nationally. I mean, this was, you could play Scranton, you could play anywhere. And now, I mean, we know how to grow national leaders here. There's Vice President Biden, and Hillary has roots here, and our own favorite son and shining star, Senator Bob Casey. The food we have, and that's what we do. We have a little bit of everything, a taste of it all. I always appreciate it when I host conventions here, so we always have a taste of the town.
I mean, Italian food was what I grew up on.
For me personally, it's Middlesworth potato chips is my biggest thing. Pizza. I could eat pizza every day of my life.
Oh, there are lots. I mean, you get the Purple Cow or the Twin Grill or the Castle or...
If it were the last thing I had, it would be a Coney Island hot dog.
Kathy Gavin at Sternish, we have her making halupki. We have her make, we get our kibasi, we go to, Kutzaps for kibasi, and, the candy from Gertrude Hawks. And pizza, I know it's Old Forge, but so what? We kept them alive. I think we're just only going to get better. We've gotten better for the last 150 years, and it's a good place to know that somebody's got your back. I just think that's what we're all about.
No, I always think that a great hallmark of life in Scranton has been family life. I mean, it really is a community marked by the pillars of family and faith and friendship. And on each of those areas, you could go on at great length. Any of us here today could speak at length about that and tell stories. But those stories truly identify who we are, why we speak, think, and act the way we do. But I always say, without apology, I am a Scrantonian, always shall be, and always grateful to have been born here, raised here, and launched from here. Buon pomodoro.